programs, I don't know why they called me and asked me to do this, because I am not an Annie Oakley. Like, she's the Amazon hunter, I am the Amazon.com woman. I made the mistake of putting a picture of myself with my deer last year on Facebook. Now everyone thinks you're a hunter, right? So I'm helping Ruth. So I do have some guns, but I am not like Ruth. She's a true hunter. I just hunt, you know, a little bit with my husband, and he cleans the guns and does all the hard work. So, and I'm from Bacchus, part of the host church group. Have 8 grandchildren, 2 children. We have a construction company. We do commercial concrete, and go to Faith Bridge Church in Park Rapids.
She's my organizer. I love this lady. My name is Ruth Butcher. I'm from Detroit Lakes, Minnesota, First Baptist Church there. I was raised a farm girl. My dad was a dairy farmer, and he wanted a girly girl. He got that in the second daughter. He did not get that with me. I was a tomboy. I was out in the barn. I was out on the tractor with him, and he loved that. But then you never could find me, because the rest of the time I was out in the woods. I loved creation. I loved being out there. You know, catching frogs and catching minnows out of a little pond, and just spending hours out there. And I can remember sitting in the woods and just looking at the critters and the creatures and the birds. You know, back before ticks and mosquitoes could kill you. It was a lot of fun to be out there without all the protection of DEET and all that stuff we have to have now. But absolutely loved creation. So I got that part down really good. And so when I accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior and got reading His book, His Bible, His Word, I didn't have any problem believing what God said about creation, okay? God said in the beginning. And I loved this day 5 and 6. They're the best days, okay? Because day 5 is, and God said, let the waters abound with abundance of living creatures, and let the birds fly above the earth, across the face of the firmament of heavens. Isn't that great? He created the birds and the fish. But then day 6 came. Okay, and God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to its kind, cattle and creeping thing, beasts of the earth, each according to its kind. And God said, the beasts of the earth according to its kind, cattle to its kind, creeping things. And God saw that it was good. And then God said, let us make man in our own image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish, and over the birds, and over the cattle, and all creeping things. So God created man in His own image, in the image of God. Don't have a problem with creation. Absolutely love it. He created us. He created each of us unique and special. I got friends that are into that quilt thing.
I know.
My question to Lisa is, can I just come to a quilting retreat and sleep?
I brought a quilt puzzle, a quilt retreat. Yeah, they accepted me.
Okay, yeah, it's doable. But God made us each special, being sort of like that tomboy, and being out in the woods and was part of it, and He's made you special too. We're unique in our size and stature because it affects how we do with our hunts. But God's given us a love for His creation and even killing it. Now, I talk about creation all the time. I started a new job 2.5 years ago, and my friends there will tell you that, oh, she's got another story about the woods, or clouds, or sun, or something, because I can't help it. I just have to tell people what I see. Mm-hmm. And I get my camera out, and I take pictures, and I show them, and they see Facebook stuff, and they go, wow, and then it's like, but one of my friends looked at me one time, and she goes, Ruth, I just don't get you, and it's like, which part? And she said, it's the part where you show us all your love for creation and all the animals that you taste, see, and everything you experience, this God thing. And then you're out killing Bambi. And I said, no, I don't kill Bambi. If I find his daddy, I'm going to shoot him. If I have a tag for a doe, I'll shoot his mama. But I really don't want to shoot Bambi. In fact, I hate Bambi. I hate that movie. All wrong. Plus, my youngest daughter, where's a picture of her? This one. She's not a hunter. I think it's because of Bambi, okay? And made her go hunting with me, she got grounded. She had to come sit with me in a blind, it was community service. So this one, when she was 4 or 5 and I'm getting ready to go out and go hunt, what does she do? She goes, comes out, Mom, don't go hunting. She just crying. She's like, Rachel, what's wrong? She goes, you're gonna come shoot Bambi, and I want you to shoot Bambi. And I looked at her, I'm all dressed up, everything's ready, and I go, Rachel, I promise you, if a deer comes out of the woods talking to me, I will not shoot him. So that's a little bit about my introduction and all that. And I was not raised with this. I had the creation part down and I loved it, but my families were not hunters. My dad's side were farmers. They had everything they needed. They had dairy, so they had gardens and they had hogs and they had chickens. They had no need to go out and take a gun and go hunting. They just didn't. And on my mom's family, they had a tragic deer hunting accident where her uncle was shot in the woods while hunt. And it ended all of the hunt, okay? My dad, he had all these acres and he didn't hunt it. And we watched every year as roadside hunters would come and roadside hunt. And my dad would say, you know, Ruth, if they would just ask, I let them hunt it. So the whole experience with hunting was just not a good one. Then I married my husband and we went out to Washington State. We lived out there. Oh, I got to back up. On a dairy farm, we had a little 22 rifle, right? Okay, single shot. I liked it. I like shooting it. Had to be really good because it was a single shot. You had to do this right. But then one day I shot a robin and I was so happy. To him. Daddy shot a robin and he looked at me and he said, why did you shoot that? Because it was there, I could have. He goes, but just because you could, didn't mean you should. And he made me reevaluate and I put my gun away and I never touched it until I got married. And my husband was from Washington State. And they had pheasants and they had ducks and geese and they came in on the fields and it was great. It was the best hunt ever, okay? You could lay down in a field and these ducks would just be circling. One time I shot once, I had 5 ducks, okay? Hunt's over! It was great. And there was times I would hunt and not even pull the trigger because you couldn't believe the creation that was going on and it was so gorgeous. But I got all my tags and stuff, and I want to do this pheasant hunt, right? So my husband goes, well, you need to practice. And I went, I'm good with a gun. He goes, no. I said, well, I'll go take my 22, and I'll go shoot some pigeons off the steel beds. He goes, you can't do that. You'll put holes in my dad's beds. You'll be mad. I said, no, I won't. Because, see, I'd shot pigeons off silos at my dad's house. You couldn't put holes in that tin either. That's good. He goes, you need to walk down the lane and see if you can shoot something. Fine. So I grab a little 22 and I'm walking down and a pheasant goes up and I pull up, falls. So I walk over, pick it up, take my gun back, put it in, put it away, put the pheasant down, walked into what we had a little apartment we lived in. He comes back and he goes, where'd you get the pheasant? I shot it, you clean it. He goes, okay. So he takes out and he cleans it and he brings it back because we were going to eat it. That's the point. Okay. So I got the pan out, we were doing it, and I go, oh, but where did I shoot it? He didn't answer. I said, no, where did I shoot it? He goes, it was flying away, straight away from you, wasn't it? I go, yeah. He goes, okay, you shot it through the butt and it went right through. And I said, oh, makes it a better shot, huh? He goes, I promise you, anything that you shoot, I will clean and take care of you. And he has all these 32 years.
Wow.
Because I know how to field dress. I have helped with a lot of it, done help with the gutting, but I don't have to really do it. He comes alongside me. He's not the hunter, okay? Not a hunter. Last year we hunt together, we party hunt together. The kids fill their own tags, but we party hunt because he's not a hunter. Last year, I'm telling him, I'm going to go sit in the stand and I want you to move through, right? And so he did. And he stopped at the field edge. And when I came out, I'm sitting there going, there's deer in the corner. Why didn't he shoot? So they shoot off and I walked up. I said, Paul, You could have had, you could have filled your own tag.
There's no ammunition in the gun.
What? He goes, you know I can't hit the broadside of a barn. This is your job. Next time he went out with me, he didn't even take the gun. I have that wonderful part of that hunt because I get to experience all the good of it and he gets the bloody part. But our family does. We take care of all our own meat. We do all our own cutting of it and all that. So we've really gotten into it. But the hunt was something I had to learn on my own. That's
so
a wrong
that,
thing.
That came from the Bacchus locker.
Oh.
Yeah, you can just have a locker plant do that for you.
You can. It's very expensive. We just have always cut our own meat, but
yeah, leave a donation on the table when you leave.
No. Good job, Ron. Yeah, two kids, right?
Right.
So I didn't know anything about guns much, especially the big ones, the big rifles, and I didn't know nothing about hunting. Okay, I've been out in the woods and stuff, but I didn't know nothing about hunting. And I didn't have anybody to go with and to teach me. So I'm pretty sure the neighbors were laughing pretty hard in the first few years because all I saw was white tails as they ran away from me. Okay? And I got to the point where it's like, I either gotta get this right, or I gotta quit. Because it's really frustrating, you know? And then I picked up everything I could read and videos, and I would just talk to people and listen to people and ask a lot of questions and try lots of different things. And then success started to happen. And then I was able to get the kids involved, and we just had a lot of fun. Hunting is wonderful, and you can do everything right, okay? You can have that right stand placement in the woods. You can use the wind, which is so important. You can talk to them. I love talking to deer. If you can mess with the mind of a deer, it's a lot of fun. Because
show us. Show us.
Yeah.
That's a buck grunt, okay? There's a doe. You can also do that. I've got a lot of deer. I cannot shoot a running deer, okay? It's got to stop. So, you know, often you can't grab this, and so you go, because deer in the rut, bucks are stupid, and they'll go, and they'll pose for you, okay? But then there's other ones. Like, this is a combination buck, grunt, and wheeze. So it's like, oh, excuse me. Wow, that's sad. That's a sad buck's mark. And then you do this. And it's just something to get the guy's dander up, so hopefully he comes in and looks for you, okay? It's fun. Where's my rattling bag? I've rattled bucks in, okay? And I've scared them, too. You've got to use, this stuff is great, but you got to use it during the right timing. If it's off, you will have. I saw two bucks one time. It's like, oh yes, I'm out there. And they took one look at me and thought, oh, big buck, we're out here. And they were gone. But during the right time, you can do a little rattling. And I've had bucks get up and go, who's fighting? And so I love to talk to the animals. All this stuff I just learned. Okay, you just kind of learn it. You learn about scent control. How many of you are hunters? How many, okay, are you a bow hunter too?
No.
Okay. Well, if you bow hunt, and I love bow hunting as much as rifle, if you bow hunt, you take it to a new level because your shots are 25 yards for women, 25 to 35 yards max. I mean, you take a gun here, one of these big old guns, like this is my 30-06, you know, 300 yards, you could do a shot like that. So there's a lot of difference, tons of difference in distances and different things. So scent control is really important. And the thing is that with the hunt, you can do everything right. You can do everything right. You can wear the right clothes. You can use the wind as your advantage. You can use the sprays so you smell less. You can be all ready, but then eventually comes down to you and your weapon. That's it. It's just you and the weapon. That deer's out there. He's maybe giving you that perfect broad. It's what we dream about. But now it's up to you and your weapon. And the sad thing about this is statistics tell us that 62% of our guns, hunters will tell you that, 62% of hunters will tell us their guns don't fit them. I can tell you that my rifles that sit here, with the exception of this one, none of these guns fit me. And so we learn how to compensate for that and adjust for that, and we can still shoot deer and handle these guns efficiently, but they don't fit us. Why? Because most of these guns are older, and these companies came out and one size fits all. But who was hunting 20, 40, 60 years ago? Women? Well, yeah, there were some of us out there, but most of them were men. And so a lot of these cuts are for men. You guys, you have a longer pole than we do. In the past few years, many of these gun companies have gotten with it and said, oh, women are hunting too, more money. Let's make guns that fit them. And so they've gone to making these hunting guns and shotguns and everything to fit the women. And sometimes just youth. I shoot a youth bow, okay? Because it just fits me better. And youth guns are a good option for women. But like, here we go. So 60% of hunters say, and I think it's higher than that for women, that our guns don't fit us. So how does a gun fit us? Well, I'm going to use yours. Okay?
It's my favorite rifle.
Tell me about this rifle.
It's a 257 Roberts. It's a Browning. Yeah, it's...
Did you buy it new or...?
Yes. Yes, and it fits me. Yeah.
The easiest way to know if it fits you is to take it and put it in your elbow and then see where your finger sits, and it should be right near that trigger. So this gun is the only gun on this table that fits me, except for this one, and I'll show you why this one fits me. Most guns don't fit women. We just learn how to adjust. Now, you can take care of that. This rifle, this is my favorite. I bought this gun brand new because one day I want to go elk hunting, okay? This is my 30-06. Big ol', I'll take an elk down nice with this, right? Okay, so I bought it, but it's a beautiful rifle. It does not fit. Look at this. So there it is, and it doesn't quite fit. Mm. Especially with this raised scope, of which I'm gonna take down. Okay, so we also tend to get rifles, and what do we buy in, you know, sometime before September, October, and we're wearing clothes like this, and then we go out and hunt, what are we doing? We're bulking up. So then guns don't really fit. When I shoot this gun with all my clothing on, it really sits down into here, and I am totally bruised by the time I'm done shooting this gun.
Mm.
I love this gun. And okay, so you have guns maybe that don't fit you. How do you get them to fit you? I could take this to someone and they could cut it off. But what's that gonna do to my beautiful gun, right? And one day I hope one of my sons, or my grandson, or my son-in-law will have this gun, and then it won't fit him. So I choose not to cut my guns down because that's all my kids are going to get is these guns. When I die, that's it. Mm. I don't have much to give, but they can have this. And I don't want to ruin them for them. Let them decide to make it. So what I've done and what most women do is we learn how to compensate, how to adjust for the hunt. But the biggest thing is then with that, you need to do a lot of practice. And there are many hunters out there that go out in the woods and they wonder why they miss, but when it came to actually shooting, they took their rifles out, they shot it 3 or 4 times and said, well, you know, I hit the target, I'm good. Doesn't always work that way. Last year, this is my big gun. I like to shoot it off my towers where I can put the gun on a safe spot and I can shoot. But if I'm out in the woods, I like this little gun. This is a little 22-250. It's really a varmint gun. It's really flat shooting. It's really cool. And with the right load, I can shoot deer then. Okay. So, but this one was sighted in, but at the end I decided I was gonna go do a tower. And I had shot this, but not really, I'd like to get these guns sighted in a couple weeks before hunt. And I told my son, I said, go take this rifle out and I want you to make sure that it's sighted in right. And so he did, but he didn't. But he didn't tell me. Gotta love kids. So I went out to hunt the first night and I worked. So we have this tower stand and it's right off the edge of a cemetery and it's really cool because I would rush home from work, put orange on over my scrubs. I went out that night, last that hunt, that I was still in my tennis shoes from work, okay? I think there's a picture. Somewhere in here is a picture of me. Must be on this other board. And, well, maybe it's cut off, but if you can see it, I'm wearing tennis shoes, okay? And so I get into this tower, and this 10-point buck comes up, okay? And I see him, and he's working up, and he's like, yeah! Then I bring my gun up, shoot, and I miss. It's like, how did this happen? It's never happened. Okay, yeah, it's happened. But it shouldn't have happened, okay? Because I was having this gun and it sat on a tower. It should have been really easy. It was all set up, right? I relaxed. I put another bullet, put it in, and brought it up. And this time he turned, he was facing toward me. It would have been a full front shot, and I don't usually take them, but I didn't want to lose them. And so when I missed, it missed and shot into the dirt to his right. Okay. When he turned broadside, or he almost broad, I shot again. And he went down. It was a good kill, and it was like, yes. So I called my son late after dark, and he came in and said, Brian, I missed the first shot. He goes, oh yeah, Mama, I need to tell you something about that gun. And I went, what? And he goes, you asked me to make sure it was sighted in. I went, yes, I did. He goes, well, he goes, when I was shooting it, he goes, I didn't hold it good enough, and these guns have a kick, and it came up and it got him in the forehead. He got butted. He goes, I was really mad at the gun. It's like, it's not the gun's fault. He goes, well, so what happened was, is that it hit the target. I go, it just hit the target? He goes, yeah, it was a little long to the right. It's like, ah! And that's why I missed the first time. A little low to the right. At that distance makes it a little lot low and a little bit more to the right. Many hunters go out and they're not really familiar with the rifles at all. So, and then they wonder why they miss. You ever heard of buck fever?
No, but you can tell in a second. But tell me what sighting in is. Is it like you're just checking the accuracy of your gun, and how do you do that?
You want to take the firearm that you're going to shoot, and you can go 50 yards, 100 yards. Lots of people sight theirs in for 100. I don't shoot over 100 yards. So, but you find like this rifle. This rifle is about an inch high at 50 yards, it's dead on at 100. Okay, so I back up 50 yards, I put out my targets, and I begin to shoot. And you just shoot, you aim for that target. And then you discover your pattern, and pretty soon you'll be able to see, my gun consistently tends to shoot to the right, or it's shooting down. And at the top are adjustments. And on the side is an adjustments. So this one you can set up and down. You're setting your scope, not the gun. You're just repositioning your scope. And the side one too. And you just dial your gun in. You know? And you just keep clicking until you figure it out. And I shoot bow and I shoot rifle and they're opposite. And I never can figure it out. It's like rifle. It's like, is that, I go with it or is that bow? I never can remember. So I spend a lot of time reciting in guns because I never can remember. But it's a lot of fun. You begin to trust yourself. This rifle is dead on. I am gonna be able to shoot anything that God provides me for as long as I get buck fever. Okay. But sighting in is so important and you need to do it with all of your guns that you're gonna shoot with. Now, that's the big rifles.
Ruth, just for the sake of time.
Yep.
It's 7:30, so I know that Robin has some things to share, but we're going to have to get people down the range pretty soon to get their shooting in.
Okay. five more minutes?
Well, that's just our time, and I know that Robin has some things to share too, so if you wanna close it up 5 minutes and then let Robin, and then we'll go shoot.
Okay, Robin, we're gonna write to Robin then. Talk to me about how fever doesn't exist, I've experienced it.
Me too.
Quick, I have a door prize for whatever. Whoever can tell me, the first one to shout it out, if somebody texts you the letters BBD, what does that mean?
BBD, you're under.
BBD. BBD.
He said they're underwear.
Oh, BBD. No.
BBD.
You're close.
Biggest buck.
Okay.
Biggest buck down?
Yeah!
You heard me.
Big buck down.
It's all right. It's okay. It's fine.
It's fine. Do you get the down?
It's okay.
Okay.
BBR, big buck.
Hey, there's two. I'll give you one.
No. No, baby.
We are getting short on time. And I have integrity in the hunt. And really, I'm going to just tell you without going into that, everything pretty much that I was going to talk about in that, other than, like, you know, in hunting, there are the fruits of the spirit too. You need to, if you're going to hunt, you need to have a book and everything in there, all the rules, regulations. Read it, find it out, because you don't want to learn the hard way. And also, just if you ever get approached by a DNR officer, to be respectful. We don't ever want to be approached by a DNR officer, but if you are, be respectful, because it's their job. For you ladies that thought you were coming and getting to shoot a handgun, you can look at the handguns here, but we do have a handout for permit to carry. We just couldn't cover all of that today, but we have a handout for you. So if you're interested in getting a permit to carry, it'll kind of show you how you go about that. And I gave the website on there for where you can go to find a instructor in the state of Minnesota. So there are there's like 475 of them on that list. So take one of those when you go out. There's also a survey to take out and a recipe from Lisa. So when we go out to shoot, take a handout, take the handouts with you. And who has your permit to carry? Anybody in here, permit to carry? This guy, okay. It's really easy. Don't be intimidated by it. Okay, so I'm the rule person, you know. Even at home, I'm the rural person. There's the hammer and the marshmallow. I'm the hammer and my husband's the marshmallow. So I love to go to rules. So number one, gun safety rule, always treat the gun as loaded. And I'm not gonna go into a lot of detail, but remember this too, as we go out, just always treat your gun like it's loaded. You know, don't ever point it where if it accidentally went off, it can shoot your foot or someone else. Just always assume it's loaded. We'll just keep those kind of short. Firearms should be unloaded when not actually in use. So, like even today when we're done, get the ammunition out of the guns. You know, my husband's kind of notorious for setting that squirrel gun up in the corner, and I get a little bit nervous about that. I'm always thinking I'm gonna trip over that gun and it's gonna shoot me. But you're not supposed to do that. You're not supposed to leave your gun loaded, so make sure it's unloaded. This is almost like my little Winchester. I got this. If any of you know Pastor Abe Cardoza, I bought this little 38 special revolver from him. So that's why I use that picture. It's kind of fun. Number three, don't rely on your gun safety. And not all guns have a safety, but if they do, don't always rely on it. Always keep your finger off the trigger until you're actually going to shoot the gun. Because some of these are pretty sensitive, so you don't want it to go off by accident. So I have my deer rifle is really sensitive, and you know, well, just you know, last year I was up in my stand and it accidentally went off, and I told everybody I took a shot at a rabbit. Yeah, I told the truth later. But number four, be sure of your target and what is beyond it. So always watch, always be mindful of what is behind what you're shooting at. So, you know, if there's a road off over there or somebody's house, just make sure that, because even a .22 bullet can go a long ways, you know, without obstruction, like if there's not trees or something. I think on here it says a .30-06 can send a bullet more than 3 miles. So they can travel every so often. You hear about somebody's house, a bullet comes through, or, you know, there's always those story, so just always be mindful of what's beyond that, whatever you're gonna shoot. Always use correct ammunition. This was a great one. The pictures on the internet were awesome, but I didn't wanna show you some of them. What can happen to a gun if you, like say if you put a 20 gauge shell in a 12 gauge shotgun and it got stuck in there and then you shot it, you know, I mean, you can do serious damage to a gun and to yourself. So beyond even looking at your box or, you know, looking at your gun, look at the end of each shell has, it tells you what that shell is. So some shells are really similar. So, you know, look at the end and it'll have the number on it, you know, that goes with your gun. Number six, if your gun fails to fire when the trigger is pulled, handle with care. This has never happened to me, so, because I don't have like a hunting rifle that's automatic. I think it's more prone to happen if you have a
semi-automatic,
you know. I think Bill had a story. Didn't you have a story yesterday for me, kind of like that?
Well, yeah, another, it's legendary, but my gun jammed.
Yeah.
So I shot it, my gun jammed, and it was a very frustrating moment. But
yeah.
Those deer was perfectly safe. Everybody was safe.
That deer was safe. Yeah.
Poor Monty.
So, you know, you have to be careful when you get that shell out, when it's cut in the chamber, and make sure, you know, that you're mindful of what you're doing. Number seven, always wear eye and ear protection when shooting. Now, when we go out today, all of you that aren't shooting right away will have earplugs, and then the rest of us shooting, you will have, you know, some kind of ear protection like this, and safety glasses of some sort. Just, you know, unless like I don't, because I have my glasses, and so I need to see. Number eight, be sure the barrel is clear of obstruction before shooting. You know, I mean, it can be dirt in the end of your barrel from, you know, whatever. There's just, I suppose, it says this says you should look down your barrel. Not, I saw pictures on the internet where women have the barrel pointed at them and they're looking down. No, not like that. So you look the other way and make sure it's not pointed at anybody. But I saw some awesome pictures on the internet of guns that were really just messed up. So, yeah.
Well, if you're shooting through woods or whatever, you know, you can hit a branch and change directions, and that's part of the obstructions too.
Yeah. Number nine says, do not alter or modify your gun and have it serviced regularly. Now, I know there's companies, there's probably skilled people that can modify your gun, but, you know, like us regular people, we shouldn't be trying to modify our gun. Up here, if you want to take a look later at the gun cleaning kit, you know, once you use your gun a bit, you should clean it. And it's amazing. I thought I would just pass these around. We cleaned our guns. My husband had to have a gun cleaning class because I never actually cleaned a gun. He does it for me, but I thought I should learn because I'm doing this. So I saved the swabs, and it's amazing how dirty your gun gets and the importance of cleaning that too, so it works good. I also pass this around. This is just a shotgun shell that my husband took apart, so you can see the different parts. The gunpowder is not in here, but the little BBs and the wad, it's kind of, I thought that was kind of interesting. So you can check that out. Oops. Okay. So clean your gun.
Does it hurt your gun if you don't clean it in a year?
Well,
it's really not good for it. It's metal, and you're putting powder through it, and it's rifles are they have a circular to them, it projects the bullet, and a non-clean one, it can get corrosive, and then it can get rusty, and it's just a good idea. Does it happen? Yep. I got inherited a rifle. This one, it came in. We've done a lot with it. We keep working on it. But if you can, just clean them. And you can go on the internet and find about anything, and that includes showing you how to clean a rifle. And I was just lucky. my husband and my son, they showed me and he's worked with me, and so I know how, and yeah, it's amazing how dirty they do get, so.
Especially if you do, you sight in your rifle, and if you do any shooting during deer season, it's just a good idea at the end of deer season to clean your gun. Then you know it's clean if you don't use it again until the next deer season. So, always a good idea. Number 10, yeah?
You have to clean it even if you don't use it, like for a year or two?
Well, I guess if, you know, if there's moisture, you know, if you're outside, there's some moisture there.
It depends on where you're storing it, like.
Like in a garage that's heated.
That probably be okay if it's good and oiled down, you know, because, you know, we get oiled in and we, you can get solvent to get a lot of that stuff out, and then you gotta make sure you get it oiled up real good. And they can last quite a long time, but it does depend on like the heat and humidity, because those are just, of course, they just cause rust. And
then number 10, learn the mechanical and handling characteristics of your firearm. When you buy a firearm, it should come with a manual. So it's a good idea to read that and learn what the different, you know, parts of your gun are and how to operate it. It's important. And number 11, I just added this one because I came from a family, my dad's brothers were all drinkers. And so it caused a lot of problems within the big party hunt, where people ended up being asked to leave the hunt party permanently because of alcohol. So shoot sober, guns plus alcohol equals a deadly mix. So it's just never a good idea to be not just drinking, but you know, any of these other bad things that are out there now. Don't mix that up with guns and hunting. It's not a good thing. That's all I have for the safety, and that's condensing it really a lot. They say a lot about safety. You can learn a lot from your safety manual. Besides that, we just wanted to let you know that up here we have a shelf for each of the guns that's here with a label on it. So if you want to look at the difference in the shells, the different size, this gun is pretty cool. This is my husband's. It's a Smith & Wesson Governor. And he needed this, he really needed this for Alaska because, you know, the grizzly might come. Husbands can come up with all kinds of reasons why.
You fall for it, Robin.
So anyway, this gun takes three different bullets, which is unusual. So it takes like a 410 and then a couple of different shells or bullets. So I thought that was pretty unique because that's unusual for a gun to take. I could put three different ones in the
wow.
You know, yeah, so that's pretty
cool.
Say
that again. That's a bear gun?
Well, he needed it, but if you put 410 shells in there, then it becomes a small game gun, you know, because you use 410s typically for grouse or something like that. But yeah, he needed it in case the grizzly attacked him.
And so he put a different size
well,
in there?
You know, then he would use probably the biggest bullet that it takes. You know, which was bigger than his other gun. So what he was trying to tell me or sell me was, I might not be able to stop a grizzly with this gun, but if I bought this gun.
What's this one called?
Hilarious.
Is the Smith & Wesson Governor. Then he could for sure come back alive. So I said, yeah, fine, I do need you to come back.
Find many ways to justify buying guns.
See, I think I need one of those because I hike in Wisconsin and Yellowstone and in Colorado.
Just wear a belt.
So
make lots of noise.
I can't think of anything else. The integrity in the hunt will just tell you to read the safety manual.
Can I ask a stupid question?
Yes.
Never a stupid question.
Mm-hmm.
You put three bullets in there. The bear comes. How do you know which one's going to come out?
Well, you would probably fill it with bullets. You know, you would put it.
What about you put three sizes in there?
Oh, you know, no, you
no,
you know,
time.
You could do that, but that I don't think that's the idea.
Okay.
The idea is whatever you're wanting to hunt for. If you're protecting yourself from the grizzly, fill it up with all the grizzly bullets. If you're doing a small game, put all the 410 shells in there.
We're gonna need to head down to the. And then while they're there, as the ladies will work with you, these guys are going to be helping out, so you have a chance to shoot. And as they do that, they'll kind of show you where the safety is and some of those kind of things. But we just want to make sure you have that opportunity.
If you want to get your handouts on the way out.
I'll take the evaluations with me down to the picnic table.
Okay. And if you'd like water on your way out and a deer stick, feel free. I'm hoping you're all going to shoot. Are you all going to shoot? No.
Yeah, give it a shot.
Give it a shot.
We'll have two, there'll be two tables down there, so we'll have two shootings.